welcome.
Nice
to...
warm welcome.
Yes, it is. It is. Welcome to Scandinavia.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on your show.
First of all, I wonder, how did you first come in contact with the mob?
I filled out a resume and I submitted it. And no,
this is not the way it works.
No, not at all. So
you because you were not born into it.
No. So most of my friends were. Usually, when you're born into it, whoever your father or your uncle or your grandfather, whatever family they're in, that's the family you gravitate towards. They bring you in. If me, I was like a cowboy or a free agent. They call you a cowboy. A guy who's on his own, you can end up in any family. There's five families in New York. But I was known from when I was a kid. I was a thief, then I owned a chop shop. I didn't own it. I ran one where we would chop up cars and sell them to collision shops, and then I started to hijack trucks. When I hijacked my first truck, I was in the big leagues. Then I made big money, and I put together a crew, and I started to hijack trucks regularly, and then I came to the attention of the mob. They're like scouts, you know? They look for the guys that can make money. And you want to be part of them, too.
So how do they ask you? I mean, how do they...
It's more like a gradual thing that happens. Like, you meet one guy, and you meet another guy, and sometimes you... In the beginning, you meet guys on the fringe. And then you meet maybe people who are closer to the inner circle. But if you keep going and you got a good name, like a verbal resume, in all seriousness, you have a verbal resume, sort of, that follows you wherever you go. Louis's a tough guy. He'll fight anybody. He keeps his mouth shut if he gets in trouble.
This was kind of your role in the family?
My role in the family was I had a crew of armed robbers, and we would take down heists, scores. So you came to us. Let's say, for example, there's a captain. I think you guys ran a clip. There was a guy who was a dear friend of mine on the clip. And somebody owes you money, and you're a captain. The guy owes you $500,000, and he says, I'll give you a tip on a heist. There's $500,000 in the safe, and maybe you clear my bill. How foolish would the guy look if he says, gee, I don't know who could do that? He calls me, and he says, Louis, do me a favor. Listen to what this guy's got to say. Tell me if it's legit. I listen to what he's got to say. If it works out, I go and I do the heist. I get the $500,000, and we work out a deal, you know, depending on what. That guy's paid. He's out, the tip guy. But tips come from everywhere. People get backed up in the rent, the mortgage. It could be anything.
But who would you report to?
I reported above me. So I went directly to the heads of my family, but I had control of my own crew.
Nobody... The heads of the Gambinos?
Yeah, yeah, heads of the Gambino family, which was sort of ambition because I kept going higher and higher, but also geographical accident. So when John Gotti killed Paul Castellano, he moved the base of power from Brooklyn and Staten Island to Queens, right where my hunting grounds
are. These were the top names in the family.
Yeah, so the different boroughs in New York. So the Castellano used to be the old boss, and he had power where his base was in Brooklyn and Staten Island. And John took that power and brought it to Queens, where I was already a known guy on the street. So,
our references to this kind of world is like The Godfather or Sopranos.
Yeah.
How accurate are they?
The Godfather was more like the old-timers that raised me in that life. They really believed in the code. They were diplomatic. They believed in the family, the Borgata, we used to say. Goodfellas or The Sopranos is a lot more like what it was my generation, you know, what it's becoming now. And so it's more accurate now, a little more violence, a little more greed, less of a code.
It's quite accurate.
Yeah, it's pretty accurate. And the fact that those two movies and shows were rather made, they definitely mirrored the respective periods in the mafia, you know, for those times. So they're done pretty well. They're actually pretty accurate.
So, if I understand you, you planned the hijackings, mm-hmm. okay? How much violence was there? How violent were you?
Yeah, for a hijacking, I would try not to be violent. I would try to, you know, scare somebody to make sure, you know, you're using guns. Make sure that guy's terrified and doesn't do something that might, you know, make the situation worse. And then as soon as we had him, we would say to the guy, listen, we're just looking for your truck. It's not you. And I'd take $500 and stick it in his pocket and say, I'm sorry for the inconvenience. I promise you, you'll be home with your wife by 5 o'clock. We just want the truck. And you know, I mean, my friend reminded me, when I came home from jail, my friend who's in the Bonanno family, another family in New York, he reminded me that we used to hijack trucks because we were all good guys. Like, we loved our mothers and fathers and our families. I would hijack a truck and have the guy tied up in the truck and tell my friends, it's 5:30, I got to go home for dinner. Because my mother wanted us all home for dinner. And I would leave the guys, and they would get me later, or I'd go catch up with them after. I mean, that's how bizarre it was. But my friends were the same way. Now, violence, as far as outside of hijacking, where there's innocent people involved, that's different. In our world, we could be violent. As a matter of fact, it's like you're not ostracized, you're not looked down or frowned upon for being violent. You're actually, you know, it's a good way to get promoted.
So have you been violent yourself?
Yeah, I Stane was talking earlier about, you know, the bullies. I shot the bully in my neighborhood. I didn't kill him. I shot him. I plugged him in the leg. You know, and I got a good name for myself because everybody was happy I shot the bully. And I was a kid at the time. I was in my teens. But I just, you know, that catapulted me in the neighborhood to sort of like local fame, you know? And I told the guy, well, listen, you could go to the police. If you go to the police, that's fine. I'll go to jail. But when I come home, I'm going to kill you. And I'm not a killer. I never killed.
You never killed?
Thank God, I never killed. I wouldn't be here with you. Yeah.
What did you tell your parents?
So I was a kid, and I regret this. Also, like Stane, it's funny, I'm next to this guy. Because he mentioned earlier his father died in his arms. My mother died in my arms. But before my mother died, I gave my mother a lot of heartache. My mother came from a crooked family. And my father's family were hardworking Italian immigrants. But my mother's family, also Italians, but they were crooked. And my mother said, please don't do this to me. You know, my father did this to me. My brother did this to me. Don't do this to me. You're breaking my heart. And I'd say to my mother, Ma, what? You know, I'd come home with a $30,000 Rolex. My mother would say, what's that? I'd say, oh, it's fake, Ma. It's nothing, you know? Yeah, why is there a Mercedes in the driveway? Lewis, you're killing me. I say, Ma, that's my friend's. That's not mine. He lent me the car. I got to give it back to him, you know? A year later, I'm still driving the car. And maybe 6 months, and I'd sell the car and say I gave it back. But, you know, I broke my mother's heart. And now I try to pay it forward. I do as much good as I can today. You know, I went through a period of regret. I served a lot of time in prison.
They got you at last.
Everybody goes down. They got me.
The FBI.
FBI, the Secret Service, and the state police. I got busted by everybody. I had 3 indictments, 3 violent felonies. I was convicted on all my counts.
How many years in prison?
So I faced a life sentence.
So you were sentenced to life, but you got out...
No, sentenced to 13.
13, but you got out after 8.
8 and a half. So I reversed my case from prison. I studied everything under the sun. I found books in jail. I fell in love with reading in jail. And I became an avid reader.
Yeah. Was this kind of a turning point for you?
Well, the decisive moment was I was in the hole. I would go to the hole for fighting. I got a little bit of a Napoleon complex. I'm not 6'8". So I would, if a guy got on my nerves, I'd crack him right away. So I'd go to the hole for fighting all the time. And one day I went to the hole, I'm in the hole, and the captain of the guards, it was something I didn't do on this occasion. And the captain of the guards was, there's a food slot in the door where they feed you your tray. Mm. And there's a reinforced glass here in the door. And he's talking to me and he says, did you throw the apple at the guard? Somebody threw an apple and it broke apart in the guard's face, you know, the prison guard. And he says, did you throw the apple? I'm in the hole. I says, I didn't throw the apple. I don't know why you got me locked up in here. He says, if you didn't do it, who did it? I says, I don't know, Sherlock. Go find who did it. What do you want from me? So the next day he came over and he's asking me again and he bends down by the food slot and he asked me if I threw the apple. I said I didn't. I said, I'm going to fix this guy's ass. And I reached through the food slot and I grabbed his tie, his necktie, and I pulled it as hard as I could. I wanted to strangle the guy. I was still a hot-headed guy. I'm harmless now, by the way. don't anybody run off the stage. You're probably all worse than me now. But anyway, I grabbed the guy's tie and I pulled it off his neck. I said, it's a clip-on, you know, you dirty SOB. And he says, you think we'd wear real ties with you animals in here? And he pulled on his shirt collar. He says, that's all you are, is an animal in a zoo. He goes, look at yourself. He says, you can't leave here unless you're in chains. You're fed through a food slot. And he's talking to me through the reinforced glass now. And something clicked, a light bulb went off. And I realized I am an animal in a zoo. And my mother didn't raise an animal. My mother raised me. She put a lot of work into teaching me and my sister right from wrong. And when I got out of the prison, out of the hole, which is a prison inside a prison, I got out of the hole and everybody was greeting me like, you know, the mafia's proud of me. You know, I kept my mouth shut once again for something someone else did this time. But, you know, we put a high premium on keeping your silence.
Do you still have information
No, my information's old. The statute of limitations is up on everything. So,
not valuable anymore in that sense.
Thank God. No.
To the police.
Yeah, exactly. If I was, maybe the mob would be scratching their heads going, maybe we should shut this guy up before he goes on a talk show and says the wrong thing.
I'm glad you came anyway.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Absolute pleasure. Thank you.
Please welcome Ian McEwan.